and gentlemen, please welcome the moderator of our program, anchor for CEEN Caribbean News, Belizean journalist, poet, and documentary producer for CBM TV Jamaica, Kalilah Enriquez.
Good afternoon. I have to say that I am so proud and so honored to be here with you this evening and to have been invited to give this the closing, to moderate the closing session of this conference here in Jamaica. I want everybody to give themselves a round of applause for what has been so far a wonderful, spectacular event. I also want to thank Minister Hannah for her elegant message and for being here with us today, as well as Darren Young and the National Youth Orchestra of Jamaica. Certainly, it's of the youth that we speak when we seek ways of transforming the future, and it was good to have such fine examples of Jamaican leaders working with our youth. Now, we've heard throughout the past few days about the power music wields in communicating ideas, possibilities, aspirations, and agency as an instrument for change around the world. We've looked at what music and the arts teaches business about creative leadership. And we conducted a fascinating investigation of the principles and practices music shares with enterprise and politics in targeting the marketplace, and in return, being shaped by it. We looked at how music as a paradigm for creative leadership can help solve society's most intractable challenges. And we had the privilege to meet and discuss with some of Jamaica's leading female artists how women in music are raising the pitch and lifting the bar for women's dignity and position in society. Experts touched by the spirit of Bob Marley and the teachings and values of the Rastafari came together on our stage from places like Myanmar, Australia, Iran, the United Kingdom, South Africa, Ghana, Israel, Spain, the United States, Egypt, Mexico, Colombia, I mean all over the world. I hear there are over 30 countries represented here. And IWF leaders dug deeper into the discussion in breakouts that looked at topics from drum therapy to music and our health, music and democracy, unequal power structures, geopolitics, the creative industries, economic development, and more. It's certainly been an exciting couple of days. And now we bring you the business section of the 2013 World Cornerstone Conference, and we bring that to a close by looking at the future of what music can bring the world in seeding hope for global transformation. We're privileged to do this through the voices of two iconic Jamaican artists with us today who've taken very different paths, but who have each in their own right seeded the hope we speak of today. Their work has not only transformed their industry with the contributions they've made to it, but also has provided an example for us to consider as we build our own plans for transformation, for transforming our future, and that of the people, communities, and organizations that rely on us. Let's take a look. She is certainly something else. Please welcome Triple Threat, Dream Girl, Jamaican-American film, television, and Broadway stage star, and global activist Sheryl Lee Ralph. Glad you could be here with us, Sheryl Diva, as her shirt says. Now, let's take a brief look, a brief trailer for our next guest.
It's
very electric lady, as you can see from that clip. Please welcome Jamaica's queen of reggae, who's recording the Electric Boogie remains the highest selling single by a female reggae artist of all time, Marcia Griffiths. Yay! Nice to have you. Oh. Nice to have you with us, Marcia.
Oh, okay.
Well, welcome, ladies.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I mean, I gotta tell you, these two ladies, when we talk about hope and inspiring change and transformation, they made a young lady backstage cry just now. They brought her to tears with their inspiring message and hope for the future. And you guys had me tearing up backstage. I mean, and we haven't even really started the discussion yet. Imagine that.
I think it's really because we saw something in that young woman. I mean, you all were there. You saw when the young
talented
singer took the stage. Right.
I'm sure Itana was proud to.
Yeah, she had it. Yeah, in show business, it's called it. You cannot put your finger on it, but you know it when you see it.
Yeah.
And she had it.
Now, speaking of it, you two definitely have it. And reading through your bios, it just made me dizzy with the amount of things that you both have accomplished in your careers. Now, Sheryl, Broadway star, First Wives Club, Dream Girls, musical legend, film veteran, Sister Act 2 with Whoopi Goldberg, and the list goes on and on and on and on. And you're also a singer, an AIDS activist, philanthropist, and other things. This drive to do more and accomplish more. What influences that, and where are you headed with that?
Honestly, I talk about it often, Jamaica had a big part of that in me. You know, having, being what they call a Jamaican, one foot in America and one foot in Jamaica, when I was in the States, they would show you the things that you couldn't do, being black and female, but in Jamaica, I would come here and there was nothing that I couldn't do, you know? And that had so much to do with it. And then I had a teacher. Some of you remember the great Louise Bennett.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And yeah. Miss Lou.
She was your teacher?
Yes, I used to do the show Ring Ding, you know? And I would do any little stupid thing and Miss Lou would say, "Clapper!" And it made such an impression on me. And being in this room at this time, I can look out there and see Pat Ramsey, see Beverly Manley, see Babsy Grange, women from all different walks of life who I was able to look at and say, wow. And they made such an impression on the woman that I'm still becoming. So this fight you see, this woman you see, this warrior you see, this diva you see, is Jamaica, man.
Yeah. No problem.
That is certainly
no problem.
That is certainly a testament to the role that teachers play in all our lives,
yes,
in shaping our character and our values and who we eventually
and mentors.
Become. That's right.
Yes.
Now, Marcia, 40 years in the business, and you're still as hot as ever.
Yeah, man.
If I might say so myself. Now, you once said, and let me quote this here, of the artists who've endured, that they do so because they bring substance and guiding music to a
yes.
world in need of it. Tell us more about this.
Well, after doing 49 years, correction.
Wow.
You said 40.
You said over 40.
Yes. The journey and the turbulence along this long journey has been overwhelming. But one of the reasons why I mention what you just asked is because when you have a God-given talent and you are chosen, it is ordained by Almighty God for you to communicate through the medium of music to the world, to teach, educate, and uplift. It makes a difference because you know that you have a responsibility to send the message out there, to touch souls, and to unite the world through the medium of music. And it's very important what we utter in our songs, and we are sending out there to the children especially. So we are very special people being in the position we are, because we are communicating to the world.
That's so amazing.
And music can take you anywhere in the world.
It can, can't it?
Yeah.
It's the greatest weapon we have.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, music can heal people, educate people, it can inform people, it can empower people. Music is an incredible thing. And when we think about, you know, the music of Jamaica and how, you know, those original Jamaicans, whether you talk about the Caribs, the Arawaks, the slaves, all those different songs really have created something so powerful when you talk about music, especially out of Jamaica, as it has really gone around the world.
Yeah, music
you know?
Is life and love.
Yeah.
Now, Sheryl, speaking of that, you touched on the historical aspect of how you can incorporate music into history and history into music. You have been a part of history for a Jamaican American and the things that you've accomplished, but you also faced some challenges trying to break into Hollywood and the limited roles for a black woman when you were trying to make that transition. Tell us about your experiences there.
You know, that's interesting because I write about it in my book, Redefining Diva, and I talk about the fact how people wanted to tell you, once again, what you could not do as a woman, what you could not do as a black woman, what you could not do as a black woman of a certain shade. And at some point for me, as a human being, as a performer, it got to be such absolute madness when people would look at you and it's like, well, you're not black enough, or you are too black. And I said, oh God, take me back to Jamaica where I can just be a wonderful human being and sing my songs and perform. You know, if I didn't have the foundation of a people who said, out of many,
one people,
if I did not have the foundation, which I'm sad at some point, I think we might be losing it a little bit, that education, that it was important for me to be able to walk with kings and queens and not be able to walk into the ghetto with the plain old regular man and woman and accept them all as one human being.
Yeah.
If I didn't have that, I would not be able to face Hollywood, because Hollywood ain't for everybody.
Yeah, you were prepared, yeah.
Amen.
I was prepared to walk in that fire and be able to hold on to myself as a woman, as a human being. Because guess what? I was absolutely perfect, because this is the way God created me.
Amen.
And I matter.
That's right.
Yeah.
Now, Marcia, I'm sure that you've also had your own challenges. Yeah. And in your 49-year career, let me get that right this time, what role does opportunity and availability play in your success? What role has it played? Because, you know, they say opportunity only knocks once.
Or twice.
Well, for me, every moment counts in my life, whether it's small or it's a big opportunity, you know, because being able to travel the world, meeting with different people who speaks different language, but we know that our music is a universal language.
Yeah.
And everyone responds to music. I never forget the day I walked on stage in Sweden with Bob, as with Sister Rita and Judy, and it was the first time in my life I was ever going to see such a multitude of people, 80,000 people.
Wow.
And in the front was like 20,000 paraplegics. Mm. And these people don't speak one bit of English, but they respond to the music, yes, and they feel that positive vibration, and they know that what is coming through is positive, and their souls acknowledge what they're feeling. So, opportunity to communicate all over the world, I always embrace, and I utilize it to my best, you know. Every time I find myself in any position, I make sure I leave a mark there.
Yes.
I can't imagine being in front of 80,000 people. That thought just blows my mind.
That's a good feeling.
Yeah, wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Now, Sheryl, you brought your book with you.
Yes.
And it's called Redefining Diva: Life Lessons of the Original Dream Girl.
Yes.
And by the way, Sheryl will be outside signing copies of this book as soon as we complete our discussion here this evening. So you can meet her, meet and greet, get your book signed. What lessons does your message of diva, as a metaphor, offer to a rising generation of women in terms of practical steps for seeding their own transformation? And let me interject here. I have a best friend who calls herself Diva. She says it stands for divine, intelligent, voluptuous, attractive.
I love that.
Yeah,
that's fantastic. Because you see, I wear the shirt.
Yes, you
that's
do.
Quite a billboard, yes.
So what's your definition of diva, and what are those lessons?
I love it that she had such a great definition. Diva is an acronym: divinely inspired, victoriously alive.
Oh.
Yes. Now, had it been church Sunday or Saturday, whenever you praise, it would have been divinely inspired, victoriously anointed. A chosen woman, a woman who knows her strength and her power. I believe that, you know, nowadays the word is so misused, you swing a pocketbook, you knock a diva down.
Yeah.
Everybody thinks they're a diva, and that's because they're using bad language, they're cussing people out, they're showing which one is better than the next. Which one of you is kinder than the next? Which one of you is walking good? Which one of you is doing good just because? Which one of you is able to stand up in your community and love your family, protect your family, and be the best woman you possibly can?
And that is a true diva.
That's a diva.
Yeah.
That is a diva.
Yeah.
There's a saying in sociology that says, your men will go astray, but when your women start to go astray, you better get worried.
Exactly.
Because that means that something has gone wrong with the firm foundation that is woman.
Amen.
So when women start doing crazy things like chopping off children's heads.
Wow. Very sad stories in the news.
And dropping them in the pit because you're mad at the baby daddy, something has gone wrong. Mm-hmm. When your women start dumping their children off and not caring for them anymore, something has gone wrong. And that's why gatherings like this, women who know better, who choose to do better, who understand that leadership is not for the faint of heart, mm-hmm. that is why
yeah.
this is important.
Yeah,
certainly. Now, Marcia, one of my favorite songs of all time, and I'm not even exaggerating here, is your song with Beres Hammond, It's Not Too Late. Mm. It just
wow.
touches my heart every time I hear it. It makes me feel in love, even if I wasn't in love at the time.
It's
it makes me
late.
Feel that way.
It's not too late.
And you also have another song that we heard at the beginning of the program, The Electric Boogie, which is mm. a positive, fun song. So you sing about
it's
love,
electric.
You sing about fun stuff and positivity. But in more recent times, a lot of artists have been criticized for negativity mm. in their music. So you have the hypersexualization, objectifying women. You have a lot of violence in the music as well. How do you feel about that?
I am never worried about anything that comes in the music that's negative, because music is purity. And if any negativity comes into music, it's like you have a stream and the trash washes at the side. That is how I see it.
It will just wash at the mm. side.
Yes. If you don't belong, if you're not coming in to contribute in a positive way, then you'll just fall by the wayside, because music is definitely pure.
Do you feel like artists have some type of responsibility to young people in spreading whatever message it may be,
of
a
course,
message of positivity?
Because God calls upon the singers and players of instruments. That means we are definitely, we were chosen to do this job, especially when you have a God-given talent. And we are here to teach. As I said earlier, we are here to teach and
yes.
educate through the medium of music. So if you are not making a positive contribution in the music, then I've seen it every day in my life, that
yes.
if you're not making a positive contribution, then you just fall by the wayside, because it's a purity. And this is one of the reasons that I believe that our music from way back when, that they call oldies, as Beres Hammond would say, is the good school, it's not the old school. I believe that the good school music will live forever, because all the good ingredients
here, here.
Went into those songs. All the good ingredients.
Now, Sheryl,
I'm so happy. I'm so
yeah.
happy sitting next to her and watching her, because I remember looking at the I3s and saying, wow, they have the Supremes in the United States and we have the I3s
right.
in Jamaica. And I love it. You know, I can hear the harmonies and the three of you all just bringing up the back. And oh my God, all the beats
yeah.
you put in one
well,
step. My gosh.
That of course, I know it was ordained by Almighty God. For us coming together, it was never a mistake. It was hmm. ordained.
God
certainly.
Doesn't make mistakes.
Yeah. No.
That's
now, Sheryl,
right.
we were speaking of positivity just now with Marcia. And speaking of positivity, your slogan, Diva, is not just for show.
Yes.
If you notice your t-shirt, it also has the red ribbon behind
yes.
Diva, which is for
AIDS awareness.
AIDS awareness.
Yes.
So you have a foundation. Tell us about that. And it's been worldwide.
Yes. I created the Diva Foundation as a living, breathing memorial to the many friends that I had lost to AIDS as an original company member of Dreamgirls on Broadway. I stood witness to such an ugly time in America, where people could turn their backs on their sick children and just dump them off on church stair steps like bags of dirty laundry, you know. And I said, wait a minute. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. There but for the grace of God go I. And I was seeing people do all of these horrific things to people who were sick. And to me, as that little church girl, I didn't care what anybody thought about them. All I saw was human beings. And I thought in my mind, because now I'm like 22, 23, and you know, you have that sexual awakening there, mm-hmm. and you become, you know, a woman, I am liberated, I am free, and all of this. And I said, if sex can be a problem for these men, women cannot be too far behind. People told me I was stupid. They told me I was a fool. They told me I must shut up and go away with that nasty kind of talk. And here it is, some 32 years later, and that disease touches everybody. Not one country has not been touched by that disease. Mm-hmm. And we could have done something about it had we just cared for human beings just because they were human beings.
So yeah. True. So true.
So that's my Diva Foundation.
Now, ladies, you two are 7 years apart, although we won't say which one is the older of the
seven. Oh, honey, please. let me tell you something. Jamaica turned 50 years old last year. Well, you are looking at one of the children, thank you, who was actually brought together, a little group of children from Mandeville, and we had our little dance step. Long time, girl, me never see you. Come make me hold your hand. Yes, and we had our little step because the princess was coming to Jamaica for independence. And I was there with my five-year-old self. So do the math. I am happy and wonderful, grown, 55 yeah. years old. Aha!
And can I tell you,
if thank you,
amen, if I had a choice, if I was given a choice to have youth again and to erase my memories and my experience, I would choose to keep my experience. I wouldn't want to be
thank
here
you.
Again.
And I think as we move into the future for women, this whole thing about age, these numbers, look, either you grow older or you don't.
No, I was mentioning that age thing just to make the point that
sure,
you've both been in this.
Older.
Just to make the point that you've both been in it for a minute.
Thank
right?
you. And it doesn't happen to everybody. There are a lot of people who come and go.
Mm-hmm,
there are
so
a lot
true.
Of people who start but never finish.
You both have a knack for mastering your craft. And I want you to speak now to the next generation coming up. How can more young women become involved in these industries as producers, directors, and importantly, owners, movers and shakers? How can they do that?
Wow, that's interesting. You know what?
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna put these on now. Not because I need them, because I look good in them. And I'm going to tell you what I believe. You know, there's so many different formulas, but I wrote something. My mother taught me the importance of sisterhood. Sisterhood. There is power in belonging to a community of women whose works and beliefs you respect. Having women with whom to speak your mind is vital to staying emotionally sane. And any diva knows, if mama don't feel good, nobody feels good. Backstabbing, demeaning, trying to undermine the success of your sisters, well, it's just plain crazy to me.
Mm. Marcel,
that
okay.
is why I celebrate all women who celebrate sisterhood, no matter what color they wear, crimson and cream, pink and green, blue and white, blue and gold, orange and green, any combination thereof, I celebrate sisterhood. But I truly believe that when women work together and support each other, there is a lot of power in that. And that kind of power can change the world
mm-hmm.
for
unity
the better.
Is strength. Well, I am truly thankful, and I can sit here today and maybe pat myself on my shoulder that the contribution that I've made was not in vain, because to sit and hear all the young singers, Etana sitting there, mention in their interviews that I have been an inspiration to them, a role model, it shows me that my work was not in vain. So that's one contribution, positive contribution that I know I've made to inspire all these other upcoming female singers in the business. And I'm truly thankful that I've done something like that.
Now, Sheryl, let me just ask you this. Apart from promoting your book, you're also touring with a one-woman play called Sometimes I Cry.
Yes.
We want to hear more about it. Tell us.
Well, let me backtrack for 1 minute, and I'm going to tell you. To piggyback on what my sister said here, you must never, ever think little of education. I would tell all young people and all young at heart people, get your education. Know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Find a good mentor, even if they are a mentor just in your mind. If there were not women before me that I looked at and patterned myself behind, who knows what I might have ended up as. Also, do not let pregnancy stop you. Just too many young women are opting out of their future because they find themselves pregnant. If you got pregnant, have the baby. Realize that if you don't get educated, if you don't move forward, the baby does not get educated,
that's right.
The baby does not move forward. So you have got to make pregnancy part of your life and continue
to
move forward. Life should not stop you. Life should move you forward. And by all means, do not let anybody hit you. Don't accept violence as love. Get it? We have to help young women realize that the best self-esteem, the best sex, the best life is right here between your ears. And you have got to be able to empower yourself, love yourself, lift up yourself, respect yourself. Because if you can't start it right here, you can't get it together for anybody else.
All
if
right.
you can do that little bit of work, then you're doing something as you
Hallelujah.
Move ahead.
Yeah.
So,
very quickly now, about
Sometimes
the play.
I Cry.
Sometimes I Cry.
Sometimes I Cry is a one-woman show I wrote about real women's real health and life experiences that now encompasses HIV, AIDS, breast cancer, domestic violence, because all of us laugh, but sometimes we cry. Mm. And a woman's story must be told, because if she doesn't tell her story, all we hear is his story.
Mm-hmm.
Ah. Interesting. Now, Marcia, next year you are celebrating 50 years in the music industry, in the music business. And you have some things lined up for that. I mean, we're talking about history. I mean, her story from the I3 singing with Rita Marley straight through up until current day. So tell us about some of the activities you have planned to mark that anniversary next year.
Well, I'm just hoping that with God's willing, I will see that year. The plans we have for the celebration is I would like to have a show done in decades. Because I was fortunate to have worked with some really wonderful, talented people. So we're going to do the shows in decades. In the 60s, I recorded with a couple of people. Unfortunately, some of them are not here. They passed, like Bob Marley. Bob Marley and myself did a love song when I went to Studio One in 1964. So I'd be recording, I'd be performing with Tony Gregory, Bob Andy, and anyone else in that decade with Byron Lee, his band. In the 70s, we go to the Scatterlights, and I do record performance with whoever I did with, coming right up until this time. Of course, you know, we climax in the 90s and coming up here with a host of different artists.
And you're planning on doing that celebration here in Jamaica?
Definitely. We'd love to take it overseas. Yeah, this is where everything is happening.
Well, that's a good reason to come back, right?
Absolutely.
It's a great reason to come back. Now, before we go to questions from the audience, I'd like to ask each of you to give us a line or two in song about hope. What best exemplifies your hope for us as women leaders who are working in turn to seed hope in a world that's in need of our voices? So in song, that's a challenge.
Oh, gosh.
On the spot.
Okay.
I am an endangered species, but I sing no victim song. I am a woman, I am an artist, and I know where my voice belongs. I'm an endangered species, but I sing no victim song. I am a woman, I am an artist, and I know
I know, Marcia, you said that your voice wasn't feeling very well backstage, so I'll leave it up to you if you're up to it.
Woman, mothers of the greatest nation. Woman, teachers of the young generation. Stronger than a roaring lion. Let me hear the voice of a million sing. Na 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 wo wo wo. Ladies, can I hear you? Amen. Na 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 wo wo wo. This one is for you.
Yes.
I see the walls of discrimination fall when the sisters' trumpet call to the front line of the war. Because we know what we're fighting for. Here's to the sisters fighting for liberty. From the ghetto to the presidency, don't let evil mislead us. For the children need us. Take a look. It wasn't written in a book. No need to hide. The Jah will provide. Whoa, whoa, woman, mothers of the greatest nation. Woman, teachers of the young generation. Stronger than a roaring lion. Let me hear the voice of a million sing.
Yes. Yes.
And on that note, I want to thank you both for joining us. Sheryl, Marcia, it was so lovely meeting you and having you here with us. And since we have concluded and are winding up with a musical note, I think it is only fitting that we invite some of our principals back on stage. And I'm going to call some of you out and stand with me as well.
Certainly.
Now, earlier you heard Rita and who was it? Who was with Rita Marley and Etana singing One Love.
Etana is here.
And we're going to sing that again, but this time
come
I want you all
sister.
To join in. And I want all of our speakers today, our performers, to come back on stage and let's sing One Love.
Thank you.
So Minister Hannah, are you still here? And Minister Grange, you still here? Jamaica President Pat Ramsey, members of the IWJ, everybody IWF Jamaica Board, come join us on stage.
Thank you.